condition of Rob's talk about accessibility. I think you all know Rob. I'll let him tell you what it is he wants to tell you about himself, but he has become our go-to resource for accessibility for first year composition, but also I think the department and maybe the college, possibly. He's the one responsible for accessibilizing.
We invented that word, definitely.
Our syllabi, and so those, you know, if you use the template, that's all Rob and Kaylee. So I'm gonna turn it over to you.
Cool. Thanks. So what I'm going to do, this year I'm the faculty fellow, one of the faculty fellows at OIT. Right? And that basically means I'm working with them on some of this stuff, making course materials accessible, understanding how to do that myself, and running through some stuff, well, I'll explain in a minute, that everybody's going to have to deal with in some form or fashion in the coming year. So let me just get started. We're going to talk a little bit about why to do it first, and so you kind of understand what some of the background is, and then get in a little bit about the how, and then see what questions you all have and where we want to go with it. But this is the baseline definition we're talking about, right, for higher education. Person with a disability is afforded the opportunity to acquire the same information, engage in the same interactions, and enjoy the same services as a person without a disability in an equally effective and equally integrated manner, and with substantially equivalent ease of use. And that's kind of the key thing. You want to try and make it as equivalent as possible. Now, when you think about disability, you probably think about accommodations, right? And the letters you get from Office of Disability Services and stuff like that. Accessibility is a little different. Accommodation tends to be reactive, right? You're dealing with somebody with a documented need. You're reacting to what they, you know, they need on an individual basis, right? And it may change like things for that one student, but you're not changing anything about the course as a whole, right? You're trying to sort of accommodate them into the existing structure, right? Accessibility is different and it's proactive. You start thinking about, well, what are the likely barriers out there? How do I lower those barriers, right? And that does require a rethinking of how you do some things. On the baseline level, it is just changing the way you format documents and stuff like that. The deeper you go with it, the more it gets into course design and pedagogical design and things of that nature. That's what I'm going to talk about a little bit here. It helps to know what we're talking about when we think about, you know, who are we anticipating, right? And it's a wide range. ADHD, learning disabilities, autism spectrum disorders, psychological mobility, sensory, blind, deaf, that sort of stuff. Traumatic brain injury, we are seeing more of an increased population of veterans, and that can lead to processing issues, executive function. You know, how do I, you know, do the work I'm supposed to do? How do I prioritize things? How do I understand processes? And chronic health and even just temporary things might come up for individual students. And my colleague, Eric Moore, who's just been hired this year in OIT to be their sort of universal design for learning and accessibility coordinator for them, is fond of saying, we don't know exactly what we're going to find in terms of individual needs, but we have a pretty good sense of what the kinds of variability are going to be, right, within this. So if we know that, we can plan for it. One other thing I want to say from more of a theoretical standpoint, I've been gravitating towards disability studies as my kind of academic field. And one of the key distinctions that's made in both activism and the academic side of things is a distinction between what they call a medical model of disability, which sees disability as a property of the individual, right, measures how far you deviate from the norm, and then tries to fix that through medical interventions. And that's really useful and helpful, right? We wouldn't have a lot of the stuff we have in terms of prosthetics and things like that without that model. But it does localize it and make it my problem is somebody with a disability. And doesn't look at, well, how are things constructed more broadly that make that an issue, right? Among disability advocates, the social model arose, which sort of said disability actually lies outside the individual. And that's kind of an interesting concept to wrap your head around, but if you think about it, if I'm in a wheelchair, I am not disabled until I need a flight of stairs to get to the second floor. Right? If there's a ramp, if there's an elevator, I have just the same ability to get to that second floor as anybody else. It's only when the only option is stairs that I'm disabled, right? The disability exists outside of me and in architectural design or course design or things like that. Does that make sense? Right. So this is why that's useful as a concept. And so what the social models tries to do is, again, it's an imperfect distinction, but it does help a little bit, to think about the impairment as kind of what's going on with your body, right? But disability at the intersection of that body with the world. So yeah, so the individual bodies differ from the norm all the time. But when that rises to some sort of barrier in the world, then it becomes an issue that we have to deal with, right? And what the whole thing about accessibility in course materials and course design is identifying, well, what barriers are out there that we can lower and lower them. We can't, make everything universally accessible for everybody all the time. But we can do better. So why do we need to do this? Simply put, access makes a difference. With the current political climate, I'm reminded of the fact that I was 5 years old when the IDEA Act was published, the first version of that, when it was passed in 1975, right, which mandated that children with disabilities, had to have a public education. Right. I grew up in Morristown, Tennessee. There's no telling. Right. I was a pretty smart kid, high reader, high functioner, all that sort of stuff. Right. But rural school district in East Tennessee, what were my options going to be without that? What I had was full access and inclusion in the classroom, speech therapy, hearing checks, government help buying hearing aids, all that sort of stuff, right? All those were designed to lower the barriers to help me get into the classroom. It made a huge difference. I would not be here now, right, without that kind of thing. So I get a little passionate about this as an issue. But let me show you this. If you don't take my word for it, this is an interesting study they did in Germany, this is life satisfaction after acquiring a disability. Like, so if you go along and you get hit by a car, literally, and what happens is about 2 years after, it's settling in how your life is different now. The interesting thing is it gets better, it goes back toward the baseline. The longer you go, the more you get used to it, the more your new normal gets redefined, or you come up with strategies, and people's life satisfaction increases. The interesting thing is, they actually tied it to one of the big five psychological categories, and if you're an agreeable person, right, then you're this solid line. And actually 4 years after your acquisition of disability, you're right back to the same life satisfaction you had before you acquired the disability. If you're a cranky person, it doesn't work out so well. So apologies for cranks in the audience. Again, really fast, like this trend actually hides two very different sorts of behaviors. Right? And one of the key things that thinking about, if you're agreeable, you're more likely to make social contacts, maintain social contact, and get the kind of support you need. Right? So that's the key difference. This other study, right, did life satisfaction, and the interesting thing is, what predicts satisfaction? I'm not a statistician. I can't tell you all this stuff. I know when a number is bigger than another number, though. Right? Demographics, small amount, 0.05 significance there. Body function and structure is actually the least influential of the factor. Right? What's actually going on with your physical body. Right? Activities more, but participation, right, is far and away the biggest predictor of your satisfaction with life with a disability. Your ability to participate in society, right? And so that's what disability, that's what accessibility tries to promote, right? So to give people the option to participate. Right? To give you a sense of the scale of what we're talking about, most estimates have it about 20% of the population has some sort of disability, about 20% of the U.S. population. Lower in undergrad because they have had less time statistically to acquire something. Also, because there are challenges and barriers to just getting in, and that's kind of a K-12 issue. But at UT, we can expect about 11% of our undergrads have some kind of disability. Less than 5% actually register with ODS, and they estimate they see about 1,200 students on average each semester in some form, some kind of accommodation. But that means if you do the math, that means there are about 1,700 students here at UT who have disabilities, who have certain needs, and who have just not gone through the system to get that officially recognized. Right? So we probably see all of them, right? We teach most of the freshmen here at UT, right? So we're gonna see them at some point, just statistically in there. And for every person you've got in your class with an accommodation letter, you've probably got at least one more without one who could use it. Right? Why don't they disclose? Stigma, right? A lot of times they don't want to be seen as getting special help. They sort of internalize that, you know, I don't want to be different. I don't want to be, taking advantage of the system or something like that, or seen as taking advantage of the system, which is more common with invisible disabilities like learning disabilities than with physical, visible disabilities. And cost. It costs money to get diagnosed. It costs money to get the certification. And ODS doesn't work unless you've got those certifications. The lawyer or the doctor got to certify that you have this condition or disability or whatever. Right? So there's lots of good reasons, right, why something that may seem like in their self-interest is not something that they do. But here's what it comes down to for me. Improved accessibility makes it better for everybody. And I'll talk a little bit about exactly how that worked out. An example, captions on videos. Something else that is very useful, but not just for people who are deaf of heart or hard of hearing. Right? Second language learners find those really valuable because they can see the words while they're hearing the words. I mean, I didn't put it up, but people with processing issues generally, right, seeing and hearing at the same time. Right? Or just students watching without sound in the commons or one of the quiet floors of the library or whatever, don't have their headphones, they can still watch your video because you capture it. Right? So there's lots of stuff. It's like automatic doors. It's like text-to-speech on your phone. Your ability to send the text while you're driving is a direct result of accommodations or accessibility features made originally for people with disabilities. Right? And, you know, it's useful. Everybody loves it. Right? But don't just take my word for it. I give you Michael Garibay, handsome and charming and dapper scholar of the humanities. He just had a new book called, he had a book called Life as We Know It, about his son with Down syndrome about 15 years ago. He just co-authored a book with his son called Life as Jamie Knows It, which is really, I'm looking forward to it. I haven't had a chance to read it yet. But this is a big deal for him too. He said a capacious and supple sense of what it is to be human is better than a narrow and partial sense of what it means to be human. Right? The more participants we as a society can incorporate into the deliberation of what it means to be human, the greater the chances that deliberation will in fact be transformative in such a way as to enhance our collective capacities to recognize each other as humans, entitled to human dignity. Right? If our project is the humanities, this is actually fundamental to it. So I just want to kind of put that out there, the conceptual reason. But it's not just a good idea, it's actually the UT system policy. October 2015, they passed an accessibility policy, which basically, you know, you can read this on your own in the version that's up on Canvas. But it basically says we're going to have accessible course materials. They left it up to the individual campuses to determine a plan. Right? A little bit of background, it came out of a Senate bill in 2014. Becky Duncan Massey, the sponsor of the bill, they actually got the university system as a whole said, we are a big enterprise with lots of moving parts and lots of course materials. This is not going to be easy to do. Can you give us some time to come up with a plan? So lo and behold, the legislature withdrew the bill. Imagine that. Just go back to this moment in history when the legislature would listen to the university and do what we asked. Revel in that for a moment. But the idea was that we would come up with a plan, you know, and they wouldn't need the bill. So that's where we're at, right? Last year, or 2015, they put together a team chaired by Heather Hartman, who was in the provost's office. They put together an accessibility policy, was involved in some of the stages of that. There's a website, accessibility.utk.edu. But then the chancellor resigned. Jimmy Cheek said he was stepping down, and so all this kind of went on hold because there were some budgetary factors and some decisions that would need to be made. And so they kind of left it for Beverly Davenport to take up, and hopefully she will very soon. But this is in the process of being made official. So that's where we're standing with it. The policy is there. You can look at it. They're still working on it, tinkering with it a little bit. But the idea is there. Right. So let me stop here. Y'all have questions at this point? So I can get the gist and the kind of whys. So this is how it actually impacts us in the English department, right? The three areas that the accessibility team focused on were course materials, textbooks and software, and websites. Fortunately for us, a lot of our textbook choices are kind of out of our hands, right? The hardware, all that sort of stuff is kind of determined for us. The good thing is most textbook publishers take this very seriously, right? Because it's increasingly, you know, a policy that universities will not buy textbooks that are not accessible. So they have a strong motivation, and so all the stuff is coming in, it's already electronic form from their authors. They have accessibility, like Pearson did a day-long workshop that I went to. You know, they have a whole team that gets it all ready to go. So most of your stuff, the hardware is theoretically is accessible, and you don't even have to worry about that. Websites, did anybody here design websites for your courses actually do that? Again, very few people, well, you would.
I'm sorry.
No, no, whatever. Make it easy on the rest of us. Don't work so hard. So you'll have a separate set of things to think about, and I can talk with you one-on-one about it. But for most of us, it's course materials, right? And for most of that, it's Word documents and PDFs, right? At 90%, and then video capture, right? OIT offers a bunch of workshops that I'll talk about in a little bit on how to do some of this, and they are happy to put things together. We have a few people who are interested. They're happy to send somebody over to help. So let me give you one tool to think about it, and then some practical stuff. Accessibility, big issue. This area called Universal Design for Learning is sort of a subset, the technique towards accessibility. What that means is that you're trying to think of flexible materials that provide alternatives for students with differing needs in terms of abilities and background, and as much as possible you build that in to the structure of your course. Right? But what that means, there's a handout on the back table if you want to see this, you may pick it up. It's in beautiful color in this, but I'm too cheap to pay for photocopies. But what you see here is essentially three big categories. Right? And because they want it to be used in high schools and stuff like that, they've given you little bullet points and measurable goals and all that sort of stuff. But the big thing is, you want multiple means of representation, multiple means of action and expression, and then multiple means of engagement. What that boils down to is, you want to give the student as much control as you can over how they access the information, right? And you want to give them some options in terms of how they might respond. We have a particular challenge in English. You know, we're sort of very writing-centric, right? I mean, that's our expectation, it's our goal. We have courses that mandate a certain number of words of writing, right? And that's, you know, kind of locked in stone. But, you know, you can think about issues like multimodal composition and things like that, other kinds of assignments, other ways to assess students' knowledge. One of the things Eric does when he does one of his workshops for OIT is he goes through, he talks about UDL in more detail, goes through it and said, okay, y'all feel like you understand it? Everybody says, yeah. He said, all right, I want you to make a 2-minute video and upload it to YouTube that explains the basic concepts of UDL. You've got 10 minutes to do it. Go. People freak out and they're pulling out their phones and they're trying to, at the end of that time, maybe two or three people have done it. And his point is, what am I assessing? What am I actually measuring with that assignment? Am I measuring your ability to tell me what UDL is? Or am I measuring your ability to know how to use media on your phone and upload it to YouTube and have a YouTube account and all that sort of stuff? Right? The way to sort of force people to think about in an experiential way. I thought about doing it, but it's Friday afternoon, y'all are probably tired. But it's a really good, really vivid for me, showing, I mean, the potential question is, am I assessing what I think I'm assessing? Am I really testing them, grading them on the knowledge that I'm giving them or I want them to have as a goal for the course, right? Now, we already do a lot of this already, right? Just the practices that we pick up from the composition program and we pull over into our literature classes, right? We're thinking about goals and what we're actually doing and all that, and that's where we're at. So we're ahead of other places on this in some way. The stuff we do with scaffolding and modeling, all classic Universal Design for Learning stuff, like it helps students kind of manage the workload and understand how to do things. you know, we do different kind of feedback, written feedback on paper, verbal feedback in conferences, right? So again, how students are more comfortable getting stuff, office hours, things like that. And again, Canvas and Writer's hardware should all already be accessible as far as the structures and the material that they're. So a lot of that is done for us. And so it's just up to us, though, to think about, you know, when I'm doing these assignments, when I'm doing these quizzes, or when I'm doing these papers, am I measuring what I want to measure? Am I encouraging them to think, you know, in the, what I'm wanting them to get out of the course? So that's the key, right? In terms of course design, in terms of assignment design, and, you know, am I doing this because it's a habit, the way it's always been done, the way I've always done it, or is this actually the best way to do it? It might be, in many situations, you know, writing a written essay might be the best way to accomplish this goal. But if it's not, then you should be flexible about it. You should think flexibly about it. You should think about how can I make that work for students in different ways. You know, what other kind of knowledge can I activate in my students? So, what does that mean? Think about options for information, how they get their info. Do videos or narrated PowerPoints so they can access it outside of class at their own pace. All this flipped classroom stuff is actually useful in this regard, right? Because it puts that outside. Again, the students have control over how fast they absorb that knowledge, whether they can go back to previous points if they miss something. It's there for them. Put your materials online when you can. Anything digital is automatically more accessible than anything on paper, because it's more susceptible to the kind of accessibility tools like screen readers, things like that. Your course materials need to be accessible. Canvas itself is accessible, but the stuff you put on it might not be, right? So one of the, I'll show you in a minute, document design habits and stuff like that. Take a little bit of changing your habits to alter, but once you do, it's a lot easier and actually in many ways better. And again, OIT offers specific workshops on, you know, Adobe, Microsoft Word product, all this stuff in terms of making things accessible. So if you want more depth than what I give you, and you will want probably more depth, that's where we can go. And then, you know, think about multimodal competency, think about other ways that you might get them to do stuff, and, you know, work through information and present it back to you, right? Be, you know, have strong goals and definite goals, but be flexible in means. That'd be another way to say that. Yeah, I've said this already, but multiple channels of communication for both teacher and student, plan and design with ease of use in mind, for student in control, put them in the driver's seat, and think about what's actually working. And then recheck it, test it, evaluate it, see how it's working. Any questions about this phase of things? So, let me give you some basic takeaway principles, right, and I'll show you a couple things. In any document, good font's good, right? You want to avoid your Gothic, you know, it might be cool to do in medieval class or whatever, but, you know, you don't want a whole reading in it. And that's, again, you know, sort of obvious, right, but worth thinking about. You know, I mean, is my document design clear? Am I using a good font? People tend to say sans serif is better than serif fonts, but there's some disagreement about that. Use the heading format built into the software. I'll show you that in a second. Alt text for all pictures. If you have an image, right, a screen reader doesn't, you know, can't tell a person with low vision what that is unless you fix it. And you add a tab, and it's very easy to do in a document in the format picture option. You know, just describes it, right? Writing center logo, something like that. Just so, you know, if there's anything in that, right? Or if you have a picture, you know, a portrait of T.S. Eliot on your handout of T.S. Eliot, right? You say, portrait of T.S. Eliot, you know. You can get more descriptive if you want. A lean and severe looking man, whatever, you know. But, you know, but have something in there, right? If you're doing URLs, have the link text be clear, because they have the option with screen readers just read links on a page. And if your link is click here or https://:// you know, whatever. It'll read that whole thing and they won't know. But if you have the link, say, you know, link to my syllabus, right, it will read that and then the person will know to link to it. And not only does it look better on the page, but it works better for the screen reader. And then there's more with web design that might show up in documents. You want what's called a color contrast ratio, and they're checkered online. I can put links out for it. I think I may have included it on the handout too. But essentially, you can't probably, can you see what word this is? Right. Not that easy to see, right? As opposed to good, which is yellow on a purple background. Black on a black, purple background just doesn't show up, right? Blue and red don't work well together, stuff like that. That's kind of obvious, but when you shade in, for someone who's colorblind, or someone with low vision, or someone in the back of the room with this presentation, I was at a presentation on diversity last semester, and the guy who was presenting chose to use red text on a black background, and the projector was not great, and it was kind of washed out, and you could not read it. And I'm just like, yeah. So you can talk about diversity, but there's one kind of diversity I know you're not thinking about. Mm-hmm. You didn't even think about that. You know, you want to kind of make it easy. So yeah, so by all means, use color and all that stuff. Just make sure you're thinking about how it shows up and on different media. But also, you know, think about in terms of, just to go back real quick to the this, they use color here. But it's not the only way to group that information. If the only way to convey something is color, like click on the red button, and you've got a red dot and a blue dot, right? Someone who's colorblind is not going to be able to do that, right? Or a red dot and a green dot. If you're red, green, colorblind, not going to show up, right? You know, or if their monitor balances off or something like that, right? A lot of reasons. So this helps people group. Yeah, use color by all means to help people group information, but don't let that be the only way, right? You can arrange in columns, the numbers connected, the arrows connected. You don't need to be able to see color to see that. That makes sense? But don't shy away from, you know, document design and stuff like that, but don't make it so obvious or so necessary. Y'all want to see an example at this point? So let me pull out and show you all. This is the old. Yeah. All right. So when I accessibilize the syllabus, right? There we go. When I accessibilize the syllabus, right? This is what I got. Now, let me give you a little secret. I didn't do this all on my own. Right? On the PC version of Word, if you go to File and you go to that Inspect Documents. Check for issues. There's a check accessibility feature, right? And it'll actually point out the actual like errors or the real kind of barriers, there might be real barriers, and the warnings, right? So it makes it kind of easy. Knowing what to do takes a little bit more work, but not that much more. So for instance, for this, right, the writing program logo there was an image. It wasn't any alternative text, right? It's not going to show up in a screen reader or anything. Not that hard to fix. It will tell you why to fix it. It will tell you how to fix it. Right? On the Mac, you don't have this. So, you know, ironic because Macs are actually a lot better in terms of built-in accessibility stuff. But maybe it's come, hopeful that it's coming in the Mac version of Word soon. But you go through, and you know, you change things and you check them and all that sort of stuff in frequent headings, right? merging flip cells and tables, unclear hyperlink text, right? And that's not so bad, not a huge link or whatever, right? But again, it could be better. So,
So what is wrong with, I'm assuming that's a live link there. So what do you want it to be?
Yeah, nothing is wrong with that, for instance. It's not what the university, UPenn had that thing, and they call them blockers. There are some things that just, won't break it and won't read, and I'll show you with Adobe in a second. But this is fine, it's just ungainly for a screen reader to use.
Meaning that it's too long, or?
Yeah, and it's not descriptive. Like,
all right. So when you insert, like if I copy and paste a URL from a website and I plug it into a doc,
right,
and I hit space, it makes it a live link. But there's another way to like...
Yeah, and you can go in and just put in text to describe what it is,
right,
or something like that. So again, if I'm listening to it, as somebody who can't see that page,
okay,
I hear it. Homepage for Office of Disability Services. Oh, I know to go there rather than ods.utk.
Yeah,
okay. That makes sense?
Yeah.
So just things like that that make it more useful and accessible.
Okay.
The other thing I did on this, and this is one of the big habits to change, is in this version, these headings are not actual headings, they're just formatted text. Right? They're also a lot lighter. I actually darkened all the orange in this document by a shade so it would be more visible. Right? If you want this to be a heading, you've got the styles thing up here. So if it's formatted the way you want it, you can just right click or control click and set update heading match selection. So that will change that in that style thing for that document. There's a way to do it in templates too, but I don't want to get into that right now. And that makes it an actual heading. The effect of this, when you do it for the whole thing, is that these are now functioning headings. And so if I have a screen reader, I can have it read through this. And if I want to know what the grade policy is or the absence policy, I can go straight to it. Right? And again, if I don't use a screen reader and I'm just a student, I can still find the grade policy immediately this way, without having to search through the whole document or whatever, right? So it makes it really useful and helpful to have that for anybody, but it's especially helpful for screen readers. Questions about that? OID had a whole workshop, and I'm working on a tip sheet for it too to make it kind of easy for people. Yeah.
I think I thought I knew what a screen reader was, and now I think maybe I need a definition of what a screen,
right,
like basically.
Yeah, a screen reader is basically anything. I mean, it's just to read what's on the screen. Read Write Gold does it.
Does it read it out loud for you?
Yeah.
Okay.
And,
so it's like Dragon or the other types of software,
right,
that, okay.
Yeah.
I didn't know if there, yeah. That part I know.
Let's see if this will work right. With that. I mean, I have it configured right on this. But it'll literally read what's on the screen. And you can set it so that it actually interacts with Windows. So you can open programs and you can go through this stuff.
Right.
And show the the navigation pane and thing that is the default, so that you don't have to read through the entire document to get to the part you need.
Right. Okay. Right. Gotcha.
So yeah. So it's not just because Adobe itself will read a document to you.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Right.
But this is a little deeper than that. In that
Windows installing default apps. Please wait.
So. But just give you a sense of what. How it works.
Blank.
Ah, yeah. So this is an example. This is my example of, this was not brought in as a text document. It's an image document. Right? In other words, it's been scanned in at some point. And I don't know if you heard it said blank. Right? If you have a screen reader and you go to a Word document that has not been read as text, or entered as text, basically, that's what you will hear. Blank. So, you know, there are ways, and Adobe's actually not bad at, I actually don't know why it didn't render this, because it's usually pretty good. But this is one of the things that's going to be a challenge for us, is we tend to go to the department copier, copy something off, scan something off of an image, post it in our classes, right? And we don't use optical character recognition, OCR on it, or something like that. Again, the advantage is it becomes a searchable document. If you want to find a particular phrase you're looking for, then it's text and you can find it. But it will actually read this whole document for you if it's done as text. The department doesn't really have the old, we used to have a scanner that did OCR, and then we went to copiers, and I honestly have not taken the time to talk to them about how we might find that function. I'm sure it's somewhere in a copier. I think like a $40,000 piece of equipment or something, like a Lexus of copiers. But the point being that, that if I was low vision or couldn't see, or if I could not see at all, this is totally inaccessible. If I'm at least low vision, I can blow that up on my screen at least to get to the size that I can read it.
Right. Right.
And that's infinitely preferable to something that's just in print or just scanned in as an image. So those are the kind of issues, right? And basically what you've said to your low vision students, if you don't do this, is I don't care whether you're in the classroom or not, essentially. I mean, you may not intend that, but that is definitely the received message, right? And I don't have access to this reading for the course. So that's kind of how it works. If you make it in Word and it's accessible in Word and you export it to PDF, it's accessible as a PDF. It keeps all the formatting and the reading stuff and everything. So if you're taking your assignment or your syllabus and copying it over, then you're good.
So essentially, if we're using copies of things from books, we need to go over to the library right now and copy them on a scanner that has OCR on it?
Digital Media Services, I think, can do it. What I'm hoping for is to get resources in individual departments.
But if they're coming from JSTOR or something like that, they're going to be readable.
Yeah. And if you're getting it from a database or whatever, usually those have been, you know, have been done right, and so they're readable and you don't have to worry about it. Again, this is the kind of thing probably in 10 years, a lot of this is going to be so automated or whatever, we're not going to have to worry. We're kind of in that cusp where we're having to do some of this work and we're having to change our habits and our ways of thinking about things to make these more accessible. The other thing, I'm not going to go into it, that OIT does workshops on it, is videos. The quick fix is to upload it to YouTube and use their automatic captioning, which will be terrible, but it will do it mostly, and then you go in, you can access that transcript, and you can fix it. If you work from a script when you did the video initially, then you can import that and do it. It's not very hard. But if you don't have a script, like I don't for some of the ones I did several years ago for my poetry class, you can upload it and use YouTube to kind of do the initial stuff, and then just go in and correct it, and it's a lot faster. Digital Media Services will scan or whatever films, and they'll do the caption versions if you want them to, or they'll set up the captioning. It's ideal if you go find a video, I'm gonna show this news story to a class or something. You know, it's ideal if you can find a captioned one, and that's what we should be. But again, it is difficult. Right? And I will just say that as a just-in-time teacher a lot of times, talk about current issues in my comp classes. You know, it is an uneasy balance for me because I know that some of my stuff is not going to be super accessible because it videos off of, you know, certain news sites capture the video, some don't. You know, it's just the little, you can't get it captioned, but it takes time, and often disability services can do it. But, you know, I'm usually on to my next thing by that point. Mm-hmm. If you know ahead of time you need it, you can do it, you know, before the semester, no problem. So there are resources, and again, once the accessibility plan happens, built into that are hopefully some resources for people who will help do this for the campus. But, you know, we're not going to know that for sure until the final approval comes out. All right, how are y'all feeling now? My whole point with the impression with the seriousness of this, but also to sort of remove the possible fearful nature of some of it. It's not that hard to do. It doesn't all have to happen at once. The whole point is just an ongoing process. We need to start being in compliance, but we don't have to be, you know, everything fully accessible immediately. They're focused on your new stuff that you're creating and do that first the right way, right? And then go back and pull out the old chestnut, the essays and poems, stories that you use over and over again, and do those. You know, and just kind of gradually build it up. Yeah.
How accurate would you say, if I want to learn something new, how to do something,
right,
I can usually Google it and find a couple of different explanations for how to do something.
Right.
Would you say that the stuff that's available online on how to make things more accessible, would you say that that stuff is fairly accurate?
It tends to be, yeah. You know, from different sources, but a lot of universities have initiatives already kind of toward this. And so, yeah, that stuff tends to be pretty decent on how to do it, you know. OIT is working on some things themselves, and we're going to have, I'm working with Eric, he's doing most of it, but Canvas modules on making things accessible and using it in Canvas. And I found those really useful in just me understanding how Canvas works, much less the, you know, the accessibility piece. So that's going to go up in probably 3-4 weeks, maybe. They're trying to get it done when people are going to start making the mass shift over to Canvas for the fall. But that will be really useful and helpful once those are up. And again, that'll be kind of in-house stuff. Yeah.
If this is premature, then tell me. But one thing Robin had mentioned last fall that directly impacts what I'll do this fall and also what books I order probably is this idea that, so I've always, you know, banned laptops in the classroom and required hard copies of texts. And my niece is low vision and she's getting ready to go to college, so I definitely want everyone to feel welcome, but I'm also ambivalent about having 253s,
yeah,
whatever it is, you know, major black writers, 30 students with laptops, screens up. And I thought about how we could do that, and that would sort of work. That wouldn't be me looking at 30 screens.
Mm-hmm.
But I am, do I need, I guess I should think about that for the fall, right?
Yeah,
immediately,
yeah. I mean, and that's a, you know, it's an ongoing thought conversation, right? I've been in different teaching groups and online discussions about it. Because, yeah, from a strict accessibility standpoint,
yeah,
the proper thing is everybody get to have laptops, you know, and you just have to deal with it. Because, I mean, you could let individual people, but that's an accommodation, and it singles them out,
mm-hmm,
by, oh, you get to be special, you get to have a laptop, you know, and it's a whole set of things around it. But if it's a rule that everybody has laptops, then people aren't singled out, and, you know, and again, there might be people who need it that aren't official.
Right. Yeah.
But, you know, it had all the problems. You know, they're checking Facebook and doing whatever. One colleague, she had a policy where basically she had them turn their laptops around every now and then. Like she said, all right, I want to see your screens. And they immediately have to turn the screen around. And if they've got anything up then, like basically Canvas,
mm-hmm,
they have to close the laptop and not use it. And so she said it only takes about once or twice to do that before people get the message.
Mm-hmm.
And she doesn't allow cell phones.
Okay.
Some people allow cell phones because people use it for that. Some people say, I understand you may, but you really need to have a laptop for this course and just make it part of the requirement. Like, in other words, you know, if it's something they could reasonably be expected to have or get or check out of the library, you know, then it's probably not. But yeah, but it's an issue and it's not a clean answer to it in a lot of ways. Yeah.
I mean, was just going to say, I think that there's some kind of software, not that we have it, or not exactly what it is, but I think there's some kind of software that, like, especially in a computer classroom, synchronizes the computers, and I think there might also be some kind of software that lets you keep track.
We have 204 and 209. I don't think university-wise we have the capability to do it with their laptops.
There's a lockdown browser that was in Blackboard, and I think it...
There's one in Canvas.
Yeah, and so that kind of for that, but that's more for testing and stuff like that. Because it basically blocked everything, so all they can do is, so you can't have them look up something if they need to. Like, oh yeah, Google that. Tell me what the Battle of Hastings was or something.
I allow laptops, and if anyone wants to talk, like, I've not really had a problem with it. I mean, some of them are certainly doing stuff they're not supposed to be, but as long as they're not disrupting other people, whatever. Yeah. And by and large, like, I just came from 351, and some people had laptops up to look at the text. Most people didn't, even though, like, I don't care. So if anyone wants to talk to me about, like, what I do that might be useful, I'm happy to do that.
Yeah, and in some ways you handle, like, you handle other class disruptions. It's kind of obvious if they're chuckling at something. You know, you're reading comments hardy and they're laughing at anything. They're not looking at anything. Cool. Other questions? Yeah.
Is Adobe more accessible than Microsoft or less?
I'm not sure that it's more or less. The interesting thing that Adobe has that Microsoft doesn't is you can set the read order. So you can do funkier things. I haven't done much with it yet. You can do funkier things with layout. Like, in other words, you know, in Microsoft, text boxes especially are a problem because we need to sometimes have trouble knowing when and where to place those. But with Adobe, if you set the read order, then you can have it go to a certain...
Yeah, I find it clunky to edit in, but if it was worth it.
Right.
And I have another question. I have problems when I just transferred things, like, they were in tables, and I think it's because Microsoft puts so much code, like, every time you do anything.
Right.
So is cleaner code, I assume cleaner code is much easier to read, right? It confuses it over time of complex code.
Right, I mean, it tends to be, you know, some of that is a question for people, you know, IT to help answer, know more about it even than I do. But yeah, generally the simpler the better, although,
well, I didn't realize it was that complicated until I looked at reveal code and went, wow. Okay,
well, and then sometimes, you don't know, how that works or function. So mindful that we are down to the last 7 minutes here. Let me highlight a couple of resources for y'all, and then I'm happy to stick around and talk afterwards and whatever. The OIT does a thing called the IT Community of Practice, which is essentially, practical things on using technology in classrooms. Generally the fourth Friday from 12:20 to 1:10 over in the Hodges Library in the Commons in the Faculty Presentation Room. On February 22nd, we're going to be talking about multimodal composition. Might be of interest to people. Jeff Rieger is going to be there. Hopefully Sean Morley will be able to stop in. And I've got Crystal McAlvin from Biology who does a video assignment from there to talk about. And usually it's just people sort of explaining what they do, and then we have a roundtable discussion. OIT bring coffee and cookies. So. And in March, one's going to be on actual demonstration of accessibility tools. So I'm not ODS, and they're going to bring in some students with their laptops or whatever and model them for us so you can kind of see how that works if you're interested. And then the April one's actually going to be on transferring courses to Canvas. And Lisa, you already got a link to the other faculty fellow this year with a new day. But again, we figured that would be timely and useful for people as they think about it. You haven't already made a shift. Other stuff. Still got a couple of workshops on accessible stuff from OIT. One-shot videos with Tina Good in March, just after the community of practice. And then creating accessible documents with Adobe in April. And again, they are happy to do what they call lucky sevens. And you don't even need seven. If you get like five, they're still happy to do it. And they'll come over. Like, if you have five people who want to know how to do Word document more accessibly or something, they'll send somebody over. You know, over an hour or two workshop with them. So they're happy to do whatever. You know, honestly, one of the things they want me to do is kind of be an evangelist for OIT, because I feel like they feel like sometimes they're underutilized. You know, there's a lot of resources and things that they do. More people can be, and it's been interesting for me, you know, I should have honestly used them on my handout that I gave you all. I have graphic designers who can make that look pretty, you know, and probably better organized and stuff. So they've got a lot of services that you can just make, you know, get in touch with them and set up a time to do it. Canvas modules are coming through. I want to point out, for any graduate students, they have a GTA grant, $1,000 to work on putting something that you do in your course online, some aspect of it, so you're not making an online course, but you're creating a module or a unit or something that uses, you know, online material. The deadline for that is March 3rd. The process is, if you go to the OIT page and look for grants and training opportunities. And there's also a faculty fellowship today. Yeah.
Sorry about that. I looked at the grant online, and it seemed to be directed more towards STEM GTAs and associates.
Kind of, I mean, is.
Okay.
But, you know, if somebody had a good proposal, you know. Again, some years they have a lot of competition for those, and some years they don't.
Okay.
So, you know, if you have a plausible idea, float it. But yeah, I mean, I think some of this stuff, and I think because, you know, in accessibility for sure, STEM fields face a lot of stuff we don't have to worry about. You know, mathematical equations and charts and diagrams. I've been meeting with people over on the Hill about stuff like that. They're more fearful of all of this than we are, in part because they've got a bigger chunk of things to deal with. But yeah, I think probably is a little.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure, because I was going to write something, but then.
Yeah, no, but I definitely pitch. I mean, like, in other words, not just the interest in.
Okay.
But I think they're maybe trying to make it more attractive for people in those fields.
Gotcha.
But yeah, they'll schedule time to get one-on-one for instructional support. So that's it for me and the official part of the presentation. I'm happy to answer questions or talk with you more one-on-one about stuff. But thanks for coming. I really appreciate people coming out and taking this seriously. I'm hoping as a department we can kind of be a little ahead of the game on this.
Do the students get the accessibility software provided for free? Or,
no.
You know, like Acrobat, for example, they can use on computers but can't download to their computers, right?
Yeah.
So
they have one thing called Rewrite Gold, which you can do a whole session on. It has an interesting thing. It will translate text to speech and then turn that into a podcast. So, like, you could actually take your textbook, turn it into a podcast, listen to it while you're working in T-Rex. You know, I mean, there's some fascinating possibilities there. Students knew about them, they could use. And that's free. But the real high-end ones, like JAWS, cost, depending on the version you get, $800 to $1,500. You're paying for quality on some of that stuff. And like I said, I've got it here if you want to model it. She had modeled a little bit, not JAWS, but another free one, that window I tried to open. But yeah, they don't automatically get them for free. So. All right, any other questions? Like I said, I really appreciate y'all coming out, and if you do have any questions at any point, I'm supposed to be working for IT 10 hours a week, so use my time. Contact me, I'm happy to be able to check it off.
Thanks.
Thank you.